Financial Sense Insider is a premium subscription service of PFS Group. The following is a free preview of today's Insider interview.
Worth Wray, the chief economist for Evergreen GAFCAL, joins us today. And Worth, we have been speaking to you for the past couple years about China. I know you are an expert on what's going on there. You even spent some time studying in China on Chinese finance and understanding the nuts and bolts of the Chinese financial system and economy. We had spoken to you earlier about the book that you co-wrote with John Malden titled A Great Leap Forward. And that was a very timely and prescient book dealing with a lot of the forces that we are now reading in the news daily about depreciations in the yuan, capital outflows, and the like. So given your background and some of the recent developments, I want to get your thoughts on what you see taking place in China. What's your big picture overview when you consider their economy, the massive capital outflows that we're seeing take place right now, and some of the other forces at work that are perhaps leading to concern on the part of investors?
Hey, Chris, thanks for having me. So when I look at China right now, you know, it's no secret that this economy is slowing under a massive debt burden. You know, after the financial crisis in 2008, China went on one of the biggest debt binges in modern history. There are very few parallels, and you know, any close example have ended in a hard landing. So, you know, these kinds of rapid debt growth periods never end well. Leads to broad-based misallocation. Leads to, you know, a lot of bad assets and non-performing loans piled up in the banking sector. Even if they're hidden in China right now, it's a problem that's draining liquidity from the banks. It's sapping growth potential. And so China's economy is naturally slowing. Now, a slowdown is something that you would have expected anyway in China, because you're seeing, you know, that economy get much bigger and you're seeing real GDP per capita grow. You always see economies, you know, slowing like that as they develop. But this is a different matter. This is largely debt-induced. China has sort of exhausted the growth model that's driven it for so long, which is, you know, largely relying on credit, on investment, and that can't go on any longer. The trouble here is that making the transition to, you know, a new economic model that's driven by consumption and services and technology, it sounds fantastic, but it's going to require a cleaning out of the banking system, a cleaning out of bad debt. It's going to require tremendous upheaval in these old economy sectors like, you know, infrastructure, construction, real estate, mining. And I'm afraid that China's past the point of no return. I don't think that it can pursue that rebalancing plan without Beijing losing an extraordinary amount of control, probably without a hard landing. And I think that the reformers, or the would-be reformers in Beijing, kind of get that now. You can see that reform has now taken a backseat to maintaining stability. And one of the things that we talked about in our last interview was, you know, the stock market bubble that Beijing blew. You know, regardless of slowing growth and really just ugly, disappointing economic fundamentals, you know, the stock market grows to heights that, you know, you've rarely seen, kind of comparable to the tech bubble, with, you know, median PEs at just astronomical levels. And, you know, a lot of people thought that that was a bull market that could continue, thought that the economy would catch up, that it was reflecting something positive. What we talked about was that the stock market bubble was really a plan of Beijing's. It's a bit harebrained, but to blow a bubble, attract foreign investors, and then that would give their, you know, their troubled companies with too much debt an option, a way to deleverage and to reduce their debt loads by issuing equity. What we know is that when MSCI declined to come into the country and the stock market started to crash, Beijing then responded very poorly. Instead of, you know, deploying stimulus or allowing the currency to drop, then it showed its true colors and showed that China is not actually a market. It's an authoritarian system where the market works as long as Beijing wants it to. If the market runs contrary to Beijing's interests, Beijing will step in the way. And they failed massively. I mean, this really eroded confidence in the system. The next thing you saw is that they started restructuring the mechanism by which the exchange rate was set. A lot of people saw that as desperation. Some people saw it as reform. Personally, I think that Beijing was very intentionally changing the way that the exchange rate was set to make it more market-oriented so that it would weaken in the wake of a Fed hike. I think they're trying to take advantage of that, get a weaker currency to support the export-oriented growth model that Xi Jinping, the Chinese president, wants to pursue. And the problem with this is that they've lost control. So a lot of people are focusing on the collapsing stock market. That has very little bearing on the overall economy, except that Beijing's lost its ability to restructure debt in a painless way. It now is staring stagnation or a collapse in the face and has to choose which one it wants. And Beijing's lost a tremendous amount of credibility. Those things matter, and you've certainly seen it affect sentiment in the world. But what really matters right now is the renminbi. And I know that you want to talk about this and dig into it, but I'm concerned that Beijing is running out of options, that they won't be able to defend the renminbi for very much longer, and they may have to let it float. That may end up leading to, you know, a better outcome for China long term. I certainly don't think that this was the right path to take. They may be able to work this out and pivot, but it's a very nasty development for global growth, for global economic stability. It threatens unleashing, you know, huge deflation in the developed world, a very strong dollar, and I think maybe the next global financial crisis. So this is an ugly situation where, you know, China has not devalued or weakened its currency relative to the rest of the world while everyone else has been racing for the bottom. And I'm afraid that renminbi is now going to catch up.
Worth, I want to go back to something that you mentioned previously, and that was this idea about a large renminbi devaluation, because we know how important this is, and so many people are looking at the potential for a large decline in the currency as being a deflationary factor in the global markets, as you've said already as well. So tell us this important distinction that you make between a devaluation and allowing the renminbi to actually just float. Explain the difference between those two things for us, if you don't mind.
Hi, everybody. John Loeffler here. You know, you've just been listening to a free preview of the Financial Sense Insider Premium Edition. Do you need help making sense of the market? I mean, you've heard the old adage, it's a jungle out there. Well, you know, you can join our premium weekday service and you'll gain access to leading experts, analysts, and market technicians on what's driving the markets, the economy, and your future. You can get all of that by subscribing today at financialsense.com. That's financialsense, S-E-N-S-E, like you're trying to make sense of something, .com. And click subscribe to join our premium weekday service. You won't regret it.